The next centre apart from platform 5 will be the 1400 train to Aberdeen, calling at York, Darlington, Newcastle, Berwick, Tweed, Edinburgh, Waverley, Haymarket, Cooper, Lyndhurst, Dundee, Arbroath, Monteith and Aberdeen.
I always had the feeling it was King's Cross was the centre of the universe. You know, all the trains and the tubes all seemed to go through there. And then you had St Pancras next door.
The railway, I don't think anybody that's spent any time working on it is never just a job. This is a huge part of my life. I mean, I made some of the best friends I'll ever have on the railway.
The main things were the camaraderie. That was it. Once I got to the Cross, I didn't really want to leave. I stopped looking to go elsewhere.
Coming out of King's Cross into the tunnels, heading off into the night, really exciting. You know, you can't even measure how brilliant that was. And every single time you thought, yeah, here we go, you know, walloped it open, raw, off you go.
Everything about King's Cross sort of hits you in the face, you know. I mean, the architecture of the place, for a start, huge station. At that time, probably about 600 drivers and driver's assistants there. So, you know, quite a different environment, but again, just so full of, packed full of history. And of course, the architecture of that roof is two huge double arch, double span arches. Everything inside was highly Victorian. You know, nice shiny wooden balustrades, and the nearer you got to the management offices, the cleaner everything became, strangely enough.
It was quite a busy station, it always has been. It was buried behind a load of buildings and a car park that was out the front of it. It was dirty. The roof was as black as your hat because it had diesels and it still had steam. It hadn't been, you know, given a facelift or nothing. But yeah, it's just a dull, dingy place.
Then you've got 8 platforms that faced you in the main train shed, and then you've got that little appendage around the corner, 9, 10 and 11 at the time, which was the local station or the suburban station, depending on how you wanted to phrase it. Particularly over on the right-hand side, as you look out of the station at night, it was taken over by the GPO. Post office, and they ran the travelling post trains from there. From about 8 at night to 2 in the morning, absolutely hectic. Vehicles coming and going and, you know, shouting. And it was like a port, more than a railway station, I suppose.
There was, of course, the 1970s, then new, intended to be temporary, I think, single-storey concourse building at the front of the original 1852 station that went out almost to Euston Road itself.
Surrounding area was full of railway buildings. I mean, a lot of them, but probably most, have been demolished or I think in some cases they just collapsed. It was just cobble streets and old Victorian buildings around the back of the station.
Yeah, the goods yard, I mean, when I got to King's Cross, the goods yard was in its sort of latter days, really. But it was enormous. We called the rails, the tracks, individual tracks, on roads, as we said about road learning. And the number of roads in the goods yard were, I mean, just, they go on and on, you know, they were all the way from King's Cross, all the way to St Pancras. And in the old days, there were sheds for, because of the amount of goods that were being bought in, there were sheds for individual goods. So there was a potato shed. You know, there was a milk shed, there was all sorts of different sheds. The engines would bring the full goods trains in, and what our job mainly was, and the people that were based up at goods, was shunting all the wagons around. There was probably about half a dozen, maybe more, shunt engines up there.
You stepped outside the station and it was full of drunks, drug addicts, prostitutes. It was a very, very down and out area. We used to have to walk from King's Cross Station up to King's Cross Goods Yard as part of our job, because some of our freight trains would start and finish in the goods yard. And to walk up York Way, you were taking your life in your own hands because you were going to be accosted.
I never went anywhere at night off the station without having my hand lamp with me, the bar that was a great big lump of iron. I've only had to use once, fortunately. But
you know, it wasn't a nice place to work, especially when you close and you're going home. So many times I've been mistaken for somebody who is on the market.
There was a lot of pubs. There was a lot of drunkenness. And that wasn't just railway workers. But, you know, it was, I suppose, the word that everybody else would use for it would be seedy, but I liked it. You know, it might be seedy, but I think of it more as gritty and real and down to earth.
King's Cross Station believed that it was the best station in England. It was the best run. It, you know, the drivers and staff, there was nobody to touch them.
King's Cross drivers seen as this sort of, yeah, I was going to say arrogant. Yeah, I'll use the word arrogant elite. And that might only be in their own heads, who knows?
King's Cross, I think, is one of the most superior depots, really. A huge variety of work, different directions, long distances, big variety of trains, working everything from 25 mile an hour trains with no brakes right up to 125 mile an hour expresses.
It had a lot of history, both in terms of, you know, its people, but also in terms of its trains, because it had the Flying Scotsman, it had the first steam engine to beat a world record, the Mallard at 126 mile an hour. So there was quite a lot of interest in the trains as well as the people.
And then I couldn't believe my luck. We used to have a train called the Elizabethan, which was non-stop to Edinburgh. I mean, as a lad, I used to watch it come through and, oh, gosh. Now, when I went and told my school friends, guess what I'm working on during the summer? The Elizabethan.
Drivers that came to King's Cross from all over the country, whether it be because they were redundant or they wanted promotion, and there was a big hostel there that they were allowed to stay in. It was at Ilford.
British Rail had an all-line transfer system, and as redundant staff we were given a list of all the depots with vacancies, and then we were allowed to have time off to go and visit the depots and see where we wanted to go. Coming from South Wales, obviously it was a male orientated depot, old guys, not many youngsters, and coming into King's Cross itself, obviously there was not just drivers, the guards and the station staff and the ticket revenue staff and the restaurant car staff. It was a huge place.
It was quite a big depot in its day, unlike what it is today. When I walked in there in the mess room in 1971, there was something like 900 drivers, 400 or 500 second men, and then you had the guards and all. I don't know. It was a mess room with something like near 1,800, 2,000 men that signed on there over the course of the week, like, you know.
There were different things going on. There was always card schools going on. There was, the black drivers were always playing dominoes. We did work as well, but, I mean, this was just while we were waiting for trains to go out. There used to be the most massive teapot you've ever seen, because if there's 30-odd guys, the railway sort of tended to run on tea.
Within the mess room itself, which was quite big, as you walked through the door, you'd always have the guards and the card schools on the one side. Then you'd have the one-armed bandits. There was two of them in the room. And then you'd have the senior Link 1 and Link 2 drivers on the table. Then you'd have the visiting foreign drivers from Leeds and Peterborough and Doncaster on another table. And then in the back end, you'd have the electric link guards. And then on the right-hand side, you'd all have a squabbling sort of second men, driver's assistants and the card schools and whatever else. And the junior drivers would mingle with us and play cards and what have you. So even in our mess room, you had a hierarchy, sub-hierarchy within the mess room.
It was like a family unit. Not only with the drivers, but staff, cleaners, porters. At the time, I think it was the best depot in the country. King's Cross.
The main things were the camaraderie. I mean, that was it. Once I got to the Cross, I didn't really want to leave. Yeah, I stopped looking to go elsewhere.
And I remember one year we went across to Switzerland, all on our railway passes, all the way over to Switzerland. We didn't have to pay anything because our passes were valid over there. And that's one of the best holidays I can remember having. Coming up to Christmas time, like now, we used to organise day trips across to France to do our duty-free shopping and come back. And that was fun days. A group of us used to get together, go across to France. Those who couldn't get the time off work and couldn't go, then they'll give us their shopping list. Us ladies were going out with our trolleys.
You knew you were accepted when you had a nickname. And lots of people were only known by their nicknames. Some of them quite funny, some of them I couldn't really repeat on here. Look at some of the pictures of me in early days, you can see I had very long hair. And I think I'd been there about 2 weeks before I was christened Gladys.
My name's Chris Loosley, so you used to call me Hang Loosely.
Yeah, there was a nice guy called Fingers, who it was said he was called that because he could peel an orange in his pocket without getting it out.
You know, sometimes you go with a miserable guy, and there was one guy there called Angry Silence.
We had a British Rail Staff Association called the Gym. It's like a workman's club for the railway workers. And that was the key of King's Cross Station in the late 70s and the early 80s was, when you finished work, you went now. You know, some drivers did slide in there before their work or after they'd worked, kind of like, not so much drink, but just have the atmosphere, you know?
A lot of people saw being at work as an extension of their social life. Now, part of that was because of some of them working 6 or 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, and there was no other element to them. They'd go home, go to bed, get up, come to work, and it was like it was an extension.
Oh yeah, we used to have the club, the social club. Days finished, you could go in there, have a drink, have a game of dominoes. And I said, have social, used to have a dinner, dance each, and we used to have a Christmas party for the kids.
And we'd have a whole train with a Santa special headboard on it, and the kids would all then be ferried out to the British Rail Staff Association Club at Gordon Hill, where we'd lay on a big Christmas party for them. It was great, everybody loved it.
I did go around the railway club sometimes if there was a cricket match on around there, because I love cricket. I remember being around there when the West Indies beat the Australians, and of course there was a lot of West Indians at King's Cross, and the place was an uproar.
Whereas, let's say, Peterborough, they were like a lot older, and they all had their own little quarter. So you just leave them alone. They never say a lot to you. They look at you strange, like, here comes a black man, and where did he come from? Whereas at King's Cross, there was actually black drivers there.
Well, the first black train driver was actually a King's Cross driver, a guy called Wilson Samuel Jackson. And whilst King's Cross was a very progressive depot and a lot of, sort of left-thinking people there were also a small cabal of racists there.
Starting work at King's Cross, I was second into a lot of Afro-Caribbean drivers, you know? The elder Afro-Caribbean drivers went through a lot before my time. You know, I think it was still there when I started in the 70s, definitely. But from what I can gather, it wasn't as bad as, say, a decade before. They told me about it, and they said it was awful, it was horrific. You know, it was awful.
I must have had quite an interest from age 7, 8, which was quite typical of young lads of my age at the time, which developed into the hobby of well-known of those days of train spotting. And so many numbers went into a notebook to be crossed off in the published books with lists of all the engine numbers in.
Well, where we lived in Muswell Hill, every night you could hear the shunting going on in Fern Park, clang, 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 and bash, bash, bash. And really, the railway was a sort of background to my early years, only by sound.
It was about 1958. Three friends of mine, we went to Scotland. We bought a Freedom of Scotland ticket, and we travelled round for whole week in Scotland and came back, and I think I was hooked with train travel then. And I wanted a job where I could actually go out on trains, and the hotels and catering seemed the ideal thing.
And back in them days, for the kids that weren't academically bright, it was mail or rail. If you could get them on a mail or a rail, once they're in a big environment, they're all right, you know?
And in them days, when you went to the railway because of the shortage of manpower on the railway, it was like boys from the black stuff. You said, give us a job. And I said, when do you want to start? And that's how it comes. I ended up on the railway. I actually went on as a stopgap. And then 45 years later, I was still in that gap.
I went along, got the interview, went for the most basic of tests. And it was virtually, can you write your own name and can you count to five? And I was successful, and suddenly I've gone from being on the social to actually starting onto the railway, and it was like, wow.
And my mother said to me, there's a job here, Johnny. How would you like to be a fireman? So I thought, yeah, I can do that. Dad often gets me watering his vegetables. I'm pretty handy with a hose pipe. No, she said, not that sort of a fireman, a British Railways fireman. Wow, I thought. Now that sounds interesting. I had pictures of the mail train thundering through the night at 90 miles. Yeah, that'll do for me.
When I left school, I applied for a job at British Aerospace in Stevenage and another place called Jones and Cranes doing an apprenticeship, engineer apprenticeship. And I got both jobs and I couldn't make my mind up which one I want. So my dad, he worked on the railway. He says to me, why don't you try the railway? So I went, applied for it, had the interview, and then I had three jobs. So I had to like decide. And the railway was £14, just all £14. So I chose that was more money. So I chose the railway. And that's 48 years ago.
Just prior to working on the railway, I worked in the Heinz factory in Harleston for 3 years. And I was an active member of the Transport and General Workers Union there. And it was then quite difficult in those days, in the early 70s, it was quite difficult for trade union activists to find a job if they were known. Nothing was around. I tried a few factories and I just got blanked. And a friend of mine said, well, you better get down to Wilson Junction because British Rail have got jobs on offer.
In 1978, I was watching a news programme, sort of early evening, and there was a short piece regarding a young woman who had started on the footplate at, I believe it was Cricklewood Depot, as what they called a second man then, training to be a train driver, and it caught my interest. I wrote to the general office and applied for a job, I think quite naively, as a train driver. I just signed my name P. Roach. So they wrote back, dear Mr. Roach, please come in for an interview. So I did. They did their best to dissuade me by saying, oh, they're really funny people. And I thought, well, yeah, I can see that. Eventually, they agreed that I fulfilled all the criteria. I could read and write and walk and talk, I think, basically. And agreed to take me on and send me for a medical. But it was made very clear to me by the train crew manager at the time, who interviewed me, that I was on my own. Anything that happened was all down to me.
We came to London on 15th of November 1970. I went to King's Cross in the staff office. There was a Mr. McKeever, very nice gentleman. He asked me to fill the application. They asked for my experience and I took my papers with me. And they said, okay, you can start the next day. And I went to the guards training school.
Rewinding back to the 60s, the pay was pretty appalling. But the idea was that if you worked all the hours God sent, and particularly on Sundays, where you got premium payments, then, you know, you've got a reasonably sustainable income.
My first days were mainly going around cleaning engines, getting very oily rags and wiping down boilers and front of the locomotive, in the cabs, the motions, wheels, you name it, any part of the engine, we had to clean it.
As a cleaner, you just follow the lads that are doing the job. As far as you've got a foreman there, and they followed the lads as far as that was concerned. As I say, I started at 15, so I couldn't go onto the footplate until I was actually 16. They weren't allowed to, so I was actually on the shed. I was doing different between cleaning and shed labouring, that sort of thing, as far as that was concerned.
They signed me up as a railman, which is like the bottom grade. Being a railman meant you were engaged in servicing the trains in King's Cross as they sort of finished their journey. But so it was part of the cleaning gang, and it was, the cleaning gangs were sort of defined by gender, really. It was the women mostly worked on the inside of the carriages and the men worked on the outside. We would be cleaning windows picking up the rubbish at the end of the doors, the litter and everything. Or else we'd be down on the track side with long brooms with washing the windows and filling up the toilet tanks and the restaurant car tanks.
I was called a pantry boy. And basically, my basic job on the East Coast Main Line was washing up. I became very good at washing up and still am. I spent about 4 years washing up. And I think I was the best washer-upper on the East Coast. I might definitely think that, yeah. My glasses shone and everything was clean.
The inquiry office is brilliant because the inquiry office, as I said, is a nursery for the railway, really. Because it's where you go, especially if you're going to be a clerical officer in front row, it's where you learn the routes, you learn how to read the timetables, how to calculate fares and everything else, and actually interact with the public without being in a face-to-face role. It's over the telephone. So the very first phone call I took was absolutely horrendous, really, from I thought at the time, but it's funny now. And I was expecting, they sit you down, they said, right, take your first call. And I was thinking, oh, they're going to ask me how much it is for a fare to Leeds or the next train to Edinburgh. It'll be fine, keep calm. And so I answered the phone, and this guy just said to me, how much is it to put a pigeon on the train to Tipton? And I just went,
first day on the railway was frightening because at King's Cross it was only men dominated. There was no woman. And it's one of the reasons why they took me at King's Cross. There was no women there, let alone black women. It was a different era at that time. You know, people could pass remarks, joke, say certain things and get away with it. And they really got away with, a lot, because I could be walking and somebody would just come and knock my backside and then say, oh, you got big backside, you know. And then you can't report to anybody because even the managers, they said, oh, it's a joke. Oh, you can't take a joke and that kind of thing.
Tricia joined us in 1979. Tricia Roach, she was the first female in the footplate grade since the Second World War. And there was quite some resistance to her coming into the footplate grade at King's Cross. Management were a bit worried about it because they didn't think they had any facilities, etc. And there was a bit of a kickback from some of the older drivers.
So it was this peculiar situation of the people that I actually worked with, the drivers, would go out of their way to help me. But there were a lot of people that wouldn't work with me. I'd come into work and I thought I was working with one driver, and in fact, the foreman would say, oh no, you're with driver such and such today.
A little bit surprising. I mean, you've got these guys that are sort of 60, 65, and they said, I'm very worried about being in a cab on my own, you know, with a young female, because she might ravish me.
I think I was really lucky that I made my approach for a job at King's Cross, because at King's Cross, both the NUR at that time and ASLEF were very strong. The union, who showed their support to me from day one, really was something that was vital.
Yes, I got a supervisor's role, and when I got it, the cleaners, bearing in mind, majority of the cleaners were black anyway, they all came up and said, Rachel, congratulations, congratulations, congratulations. I says, why? They says, you've done it. I've been put on a pedestal here. They're looking at me, they're watching me, because the first time we've had a female supervisor on the station, and not only female supervisor, a black female supervisor on the station. But then it opened gates because other female thought, If Rachel can do it, they can do it.
I worked at Top Shed, which was the shed allocated to King's Cross. It all came under the King's Cross umbrella, but it was a large shed which we were governed by a shed master. That's an old-fashioned title nowadays, isn't it? The shed master, who was an ex-engineer, and then we had outside foremen that placed the engines after they came on the shed, turned, watered, cold, had their fires clean, smoke box clean. Then they would put them in position for the way they would leave the shed. So they're all set in order. So that's where I started life. When the last steam engine went, Top Shed closed down and was razed to the ground. And then we all migrated down to King's Cross.
I go up into the signal box. We're surrounded by our 80-foot long horseshoe-shaped control panel, and the trains are red lights with identity numbers on little screens popping around along the tracks. And you're confronted then with the panorama of the whole show, with five signalmen working, station announcer almost directly in front of you, looking at the King's Cross control end of the panel.
We're working directly with the signalmen. And, you know, the King's Cross signalman was right in front of me, and then the supervisors were at the side of me. Most of the men that had come into the signal box had men who were men who had been used to working outside boxes, you know, so they worked on their own sort of thing, you know. They found it about difficult coping with a crowd of people all in the same room because it was taking them out of their comfort zone, basically.
But King's Cross was all electric and had 232 miniature levers about this size to operate everything between the platforms and the tunnel and just out the other side of the tunnel.
I don't want to upset any of you English people, but they found that Irish, Northern Irish and Scottish voices carried better over the PA system.
When I started, the kitchen cars we had were 1928 vintage, but they were very, very, very old and very worn out by 1959. I had two fire buckets which I purloined from various places, and I used to go up on the engine and get hot water off the engine. And I come back one day and I put one of my buckets of water in my washing up to wash up. And when I turned around, the chef had stolen the other one and he was making the afternoon tea for the passengers. I just hope there was no coal dust in this one. One of the things that I learned very quickly was that there were certain bits of track on the East Coast Main Line that were not quite as good as they should be because they'd still been damaged during the war. Three in particular, one the other side of Benton. Most of the chefs used to come out the kitchen when you got to this junction because the train used to rock about. We had vacuum brakes in them days, which when the driver put the brake on, if you put it on full, you stopped in a big heap, basically. So you'd be hanging on to things in the cupboards and making sure nothing fell out. In them days, lunch was 9 and 6 pence, dinner was 10 and 6 pence, and they were four-course meals. There was a soup or juice or grapefruit or something, then a fish course, then a main course, and a sweet or cheese and biscuits. So it was quite a big meal. You find on some of the trains, like at the 1 o'clock from London, we used to go to Edinburgh on that, people would come in and have lunch. And they'd come and have afternoon tea, which was toast, tea cake, sandwiches, coffee. And then they'd come back later on and have dinner. I mean, you can imagine when I went home to see my mum, I said, what these people eat, it's unbelievable. They eat more in a day than I got in a week.
I was a relief supervisor, and I covered all the supervisors, all the supervisory posts, train movements, platform supervisors, cleaning supervisor, senior ticket supervisor. My last job was having to shunt the Royal train into perfect position.
Of course, one of the most important things was to measure it all out to make sure that the train stopped dead centre,
where the red carpet was, because my God, it was hanging offensive if you got that wrong.
Now, when you think his coach was at the back of train, I'm at the front trying to give hand signals to the driver and listening to my colleague on the radio saying, bit more, all right, that's it, yeah. Then I've got to give the driver the red signal. But it worked. I think it was one of the last jobs I did, and I started as a youth training coordinator. Best job I ever had.
Early years, I worked as a guard. And the guard, what we did was, we were doing tickets. We were doing customer services on the train. We sell tickets. Safety is priority. In case there's derailment or anything like that, you had the skills to be able to connect the trains together or uncouple the trains.
Before the departure of the train, I always used to make the announcement, which, you know, some people found funny. They used to have tetras. I used to say, anybody found hiding in the toilet will be flushed out. Like sometimes some people used to pretend that they didn't speak English. And I say, okay, no worries. And like the person who would say that he doesn't speak English, I say, excuse me, is that your fiver on the floor? What? I say, you can speak English, can't pay up.
If the train is delayed, you get quite a lot of abuse. And, you know, at times people become personal. They say all sort of things. But, you know, you have to take it.
I used to get 5% commission on any ticket I sold. And one day I was working this train from Newcastle, and we had this man and his son get on the train. And I went up to him and I said, take it. Oh, I need to buy a ticket. So I sold him the ticket. And I said, what about the boy? Oh, he's only 4. No, I'm 7. Shut up, you're 4. I said, you have to buy the ticket.
The toilet was locked, and I knocked. Nobody answered. So I said, okay, then I have to open the toilet. They think that we can open the toilet because they've locked it inside. So I opened the toilet with my key, and there, 2 lovers were at it. I closed the door and I said, hurry up and come out. And then they came out. I told them, okay, you're using my toilet as a hotel. You could have waited until you got in home, but you haven't. So I'm charging you £20, you know, for bread and breakfast. I'll give you a cup of tea, and then you can, you've already used the toilet. So they were in a hurry. They brought the £20 out, and then the guy gave me £10 in addition. Oh, I apologize, blah, blah, blah. I said, no, that's all right. But I gave the money back to them.
The line of promotion, which governs all footplate men, the grades go in order of cleaner. You pass the exam and become a passed cleaner. Then you become a second man. Then you pass a driving exam to become a passed second man. And then finally you're appointed as a driver. All done strictly on seniority from the day you join the railway. So that's the order of progression.
Initially, we had a 2-week course. This was basically about how to keep yourself safe in a working environment such as we were in. But also how to fire to an engine, how to shovel coal. They didn't take us on an engine. All they had was a big bin at the side with a fire hole door welded to it and a small bunker of coal. And we had to practice getting the coal, swinging it and putting it into this metal box in the different locations where it needed to go. And I can remember the first session. By the time we finished, there was more coal on the platform than there was in the box. And we all thought, ouch, this is more difficult than we thought.
Well, the training was really, you went with an experienced fireman for a couple of weeks to get used to the idea of how you handled the pickaxe, the shovel, the fire irons. and then you were virtually on your own with a driver. As a fireman, your job was mainly to get the engine ready. So you'd make sure the coal bunker was full, the water tank was full, and there was a fire in the fire hole. It wasn't dead. And then you'd gradually fill the firebox up with coal so that you've got a fire going really well in it.
You've got water troughs with the mainline engines. You used to drop a scoop when you approach the trough, and the scoop takes up the water into the water tank.
The longest job we had at King's Cross was to York and back in 8 hours. Now that was nearly 200 miles there, nearly 200 miles back. That would be round about 9 to 10 tons of coal and just one fireman.
There was a men's barber shop and a ladies' barber shop on the train. Yeah. Much to the annoyance of the firemen, because every time they put a cinema coach on or a barber shop, it was another coach. And of course, that was another half a ton of coal they would have to shovel.
Because you're shoveling something like a ton of coal an hour on an express, not too many drivers would let you do the driving because they would have to do the shoveling. What I liked about the diesels coming along at that time was that meant that I could share the driving, something that never happened on steam engines.
I remember looking up to the elder drivers. They were gods. They were absolute gods because these guys had fired on steam and then they'd gone on to the diesels in the late 60s, you know. And I remember just admiring these guys.
There's a second man, basically the highest paid tea boy that was ever on the railway to a certain extent, because you make drivers tea, but you get down on the phone to the signalman for the driver and say we're detained at. If you had to couple up two locomotives, that was the second man's job for a double header.
Most of the trains were heated by steam boilers. So although we had diesel engines, to heat the trains, there was a blooming great big boiler squeezed into the engine room. Right? And our job as driver's assistants was to set the boiler going, make sure the steam was going through the train. We would couple and uncouple at times if we were in yards, but not at King's Cross, because we had chances to do that. If the boiler broke down, we'd have to attend to the boiler. And you teamed up, so you sometimes had a regular driver for maybe 6 months. So you got to know each other very well. You became a really close-knit couple, almost like an uncle and nephew kind of relationship.
I started in 1978. I did 6 years as a driver's assistant. And in them 6 years, you just watched the driver. You watched him. And it was a form of an apprenticeship. When he had confidence in you, he let you have a go. And for them to let you have a go, wow, that was like winning a lottery. You know, you're driving this big trainer, for example, like a Class 55 Deltic, which really they only run on our line on the East Coast. And I remember sitting there driving this train under his instruction, and I'm thinking, 20 years old, I'm driving this 500-ton train with people sleep on it because they were the overnight sleepers from London to Doncaster, and I'm thinking, wow.
After all the practical experience that I got through the drivers, I then went on a training course, something that was called MP12. And that was a 6-month training course where you learn everything. I mean, literally everything. The railway rule book was really thick.
People would ask you if you'd passed your exams the first or second time. You got 3 goes at it. It was very extraordinary to pass on the third time, because usually that would mean you weren't going to pass at all. Most people pass second time.
And in 1984, the steam heating kind of died off. So second man's job was arguably becoming obsolete. And that was the time that I passed out for driving.
It was all done on the footplate through going up through the different links. A link is simply a group of work going from the little shunt jobs at the bottom to the Newcastle jobs at the top. And usually, every time you moved up, you got either a better quality of work or a little bit more money or if you're lucky, a bit of each.
Because if you can imagine a train driver on the suburban Hartford North Loop, they go backwards and forwards, and doing 150 stops a day, and it can be pretty tedious. And most people didn't like those kind of jobs. But if you're doing a Newcastle return or a Leeds return, you're belting up the main line, you only maybe stop three or four places. So it's a more relaxed work on the main line.
We had a huge freight terminal at King's Cross with about 8 different locomotives punching wagons up and down it. And then we started getting short trip jobs outside, and then you get your first passenger train, local suburban train, and it just went on as you progressed up through the links. It was done on seniority.
It gives you something to look forward to, getting up to the top link eventually and earning loads of money. So you came there with that in mind, that start at the bottom, eventually you'll get to the top and you'll be earning good money.
Well, for one, when you passed out, you felt great because you're in charge of your own train. And as long as you followed the rules and regulations, nobody troubled you. And the first trip was a bit daunting because I did an afternoon shift on my own. And half was in the daylight and half was at night. And night driving was a little bit different from day. But as you got on, you just became used to it.
Coming out of King's Cross into the tunnels, heading off into the night, really exciting. You know, you can't even measure how brilliant that was. And every single time you thought, yeah, here we go, you know, walloped it open, raw, off you go.
The scenery on the journey is so different because you come out of King's Cross and you know you're going into Gasworks Tunnel straight away. So going into the Gasworks Tunnel is quite good because you come out of that, then you're on the second tunnel. So you've got all that kind of industrial stuff of the tunnels. Because you're on the main line, you're zipping past Finsbury Park. You go through some beautiful places going up the East Coast Main Line, going up to York. I mean, York's a beautiful station in itself, lovely architecture. You've got things like the Welwyn Viaduct, which is a wonderful part of countryside, and you see it in the spring, you see it in the summer, you see it in the winter, so you can see it full of snow.
There was a lot of prestige. We were working the most famous engines on the fastest trains in the country. Being in a crew of two men, if you were with your regular mate or some of the guys you really got on well with, it was an enjoyable day. The day had passed very quickly. It wouldn't feel as though you'd been at work at all. It would feel as though you'd had a day out.
Belting down the East Coast Main Line at sort of 100 mile an hour was great, because obviously in the freight job that I did previously, we were governed to sort of 25 miles an hour, very loose coupled train, very slow. Now you just run at 100 mile an hour and put the brake on and it stopped. It was wonderful.
Over time, you became qualified to know every single speed, every single junction, every single tunnel, signal, bridge, absolutely everything. And that enabled us to drive those trains at full speed in the fog or snow or anything like that. Excuse the expression, but you'd drive a train with your ears and your ass. You'd feel where you were and hear where you were. But there was also mileage payments, which the further you went in a day's work, the more miles you covered, the more pay you got. And at King's Cross, we were doing very long distances. In fact, the longest runs in the country at that time. So we were earning a lot of money once you got onto those trains.
My favourite job would be a Grantham return, which was going to give me a nice 5 hours mileage, but without being too hard work. It's only less than 2 hours to Grantham. It was a nice little country town where you could go for a nice stroll outside, get a bit of fish and chips, and have a look round, and then work one back, and without doing too much work, you got good money. That would be my favourite day's work.
I was very lucky during my career. I only had one under and one near, which over the course of the time, that is good. The average is about one every 8 to 10 years. But yeah, that was quite an experience that night, you know, was something I didn't want to relive. But he was, I only hit him at 15 mile an hour. I had to go under the train to him. He's still alive, but he died a few hours later out of New Barnet. But it happens. It made me fall apart a bit.
I said it's my longest day and my shortest shift. Was when they had the Potter's Bar crash. It was sort of strange, whereas I didn't expect it to be derailed, not the way it was. That was a scary moment because when I actually saw what happened, the derailment, and what could have happened if I didn't, like, did my training and put my track circuit clips down there. That was the scariest part of Potter's Bar for me, not knowing that the track circuit clips stopped the trains coming. I just put them down and hoped for the best. I went straight to the telephone to ring the signal box up, and none of them worked because the train cut the cables, so I never had no phone. So that was hard to deal with, thinking I was on my own. You just know that you've got things to do, and you just, and there's loads of things go through your head. I mean, when I eventually got through the signalman, and he says to me that trains are stopped, it was a massive relief, like, you know.
Roughly between about 1967 and about 1974, roughly, that is the period where we got our first diesels starting and then the last steam engine leaving.
The newer trains obviously are a lot more complicated, a lot more electronics involved. And going back to the old days with the old drivers, you know, a lot of them used to push bike to work, a lot of them didn't drive, and they were all brought up on steam engines and hit things with hammers and clinking and banging, and a lot of them were actually afraid of circuit breakers and fuses, and they wouldn't let you turn the cooker off or the boiler off in case.
These poor devils, they come back off their latest training course, and if you was their regular mate, they generally throw their book at you, say, you better read this, you know, you understand this stuff better than we do. Some of them were 60, you know, and they've never seen a diesel before. Now they've got to drive them. So, yeah, I've seen the technological change, and it was quite frightening for some of them.
The Deltics, I'm just thinking about the Deltics, because they're quite a unique engine, you know, and they're like a, I don't know, 100 tonne of loco, and they can pull a 300 ton train at 100 mile an hour. So they're a huge bit of kit.
I think they were designed for high speed, and you sat quite a high way up in the cab and you look out. So once you're doing 100 mile an hour, everything seems to be going by. It felt like you're doing it 200 mile an hour.
We used to work at King's Cross with an old English Electric 2000s. The class 40s, and you had to chase up times, and you'd be leaning out the window, come on, you passengers, get in, I'm never going to keep time with this engine. You never had that with a Deltic.
Electrification obviously took off. I mean, King's Cross was electrified 1977, just before I got there. So the new inner suburban system and the outer suburban system had been electrified, so a lot of the older diesel trains had gone. So there was a change on the King's Cross power signal box had come into play. And the old boxes had gone. So there was a lot of technical changes at King's Cross itself. A lot of the old infrastructure was still there.
Then obviously, as the diesels got phased out for electrics, all of these, you had to go to a classroom and learn about them and learn the ins and outs of their problems and things that you could put right and things that you couldn't put right, where you had to shout help.
But there's a lot you had to get used to yourself, the quietness. I think that's what I found most with the electrics, and it's quiet.
One thing I really didn't like is when the work pattern shifted and we went from being a full train crew to just a driver and you were all by yourself all day. Sometimes you got a whole day without speaking to anybody else at all, and I really didn't like that.
I can say it as an outsider because I wasn't here at the time, but it was always seen as quite a militant depot. You know, some of the southern region depots were seen as militant, but King's Cross was always seen as a real hotbed of militant drivers.
It was a period, the 70s and 80s, of constant attack on the working conditions of drivers. I suppose that really culminated in 1982 when management said that they were going to bring in something called flexible rostering. Initially, they wanted drivers to be able to work either 4 hours up to 12 hours a day. And that was a real attack on conditions.
1982, when we came out, we get paid a week in arrears, you know? So the first week we're out, we've still got money. You know, this was a 2 week strike in 1982. Second week, we got no money because we've got no wages. My mum said to me, you've got to go work. I said, Mum, I can't go work. She said, you've got to go work. So I went to see Aslef. And I went to the branch secretary and explained my predicament. And he said, how much do you give your mum? I said, £25 a week. So he gave me £30 out of the hardship fund. And he says, here, he said, keep the five and get yourself a drink. And he did the same for the second week when we were down money as well. I never forgot that.
But I mean, we had quite a few different strikes at King's Cross, either national strikes called by a head office, or some of our own personal little strikes, like against the Sun. The Sun virtually called us all a load of lazy, good-for-nothings, getting something for nothing, and really making us look bad. So what we did, we said, right, we've got the newspaper trains, we'll still work them, but we won't take any Sun newspapers on them.
There was a train at 21:45, which only contained Sun newspapers, and two of our toppling drivers used to work it. So, because our guys refused to work it, so it sat there. I think this went on for about an hour and a half. Well, it was just absolute carnage. The station filled up and trains couldn't come in. Trains were stuck right the way down, now down East Coast Main Line. And he gave in the end, and he said, right, get it off. So everybody was down there, myself included, you know, throwing these bundles of Scum newspapers off the train and onto the platforms. And then the two original drivers got on it and out it went, and it was like somebody pulling a plug out of a sink. The whole thing folded out. Like, so that was an interest. I was 19 then, and that was an interesting evening.
Prior to privatisation, they started sectorising all the work. So if you was on intercities, you was on intercities all the time. If you was on local commuter trains, you ended up just doing them.
It was compartmentalised, which is not how the culture I was brought up in. You know, we were one industry, one company, and you know, even down to the fact of the hotels and the catering outlets on the station were all part of British Rail.
Pay didn't improve for train drivers until privatisation.
We was working as a nationalised industry for one person, and that was the government or one firm. You suddenly had 26 tocks that wanted drivers. They then have to start to put their head in gear and say, we need to keep drivers, otherwise they're sodding off on the Western or they're going down here because they're paying a better wage. And so it starts to go up. And that's how it chased itself. And that's where you get to the high value that drivers are paid now.
They were obviously trying to poach them from the less well-paid freight depots and commuter railway companies. And if you're poaching drivers, it saves you having to pay to recruit them and train them.
The variety for all the drivers on the railway now has gone. You're allocated to one type of sector of work, and that's it. And you don't get the variety or the number of routes that we used to. And that's one of the reasons I think I had the best years. We used to go lots of different places on every type of train. It was great.
The train at platform 5 was the 1333 LNER Azuma service to Harrogate.
Best thing that ever happened at King's Cross was Eurostar coming into St Pancras, because they had to get their finger out and square it up, like, you know, because it then become the gateway to England or Great Britain, you know, from the continent.
But we came there on that Sunday morning, 2012, and looked in it, and wow, you know, this is, considering what we had at the Western Concourse, this so much brighter, so much larger, you know, and clean. Most remarkable thing that we noticed, first of all, was they'd actually cleaned the train shed roof between 1 and 8. All of a sudden, you saw the sky out there, which you'd never saw before.
People just kept turning up, and especially Japanese tourists. They love Harry Potter. And they go, Harry Potter, where's platform 9 3/4? There isn't one. And somebody had the bright idea going, look, we've got all these tourists turning up. We've got to do something. Somebody had the right bright idea of chopping a trolley in half, a luggage trolley in half, and bolting it to the wall. And they put up a little notice, hand-done notice at first it was, 9 3/4. And so we had somewhere to direct these people to, and they kept asking.
As I said, you know, 16-year-old getting paid for something that you enjoyed doing. Even now, 40-odd years later, I still get that same buzz when I go out and drive trains. I just feel really fortunate that I've had the career I have had doing something that has infused me, giving me life opportunities that I wouldn't have had. And also the upside to that is my trade union activities as a bolt-on. It's just been, you know, I'd live it all again. It's been brilliant.
This is a huge part of my life. I mean, I made some of the best friends I'll ever have on the railway. I'm still friends with them today. I mean, 40-odd years friendship is huge, isn't it?
I love working at King's Cross, even now at my age. I get up early at 4 o'clock in the morning. I go to work. I look forward, you know, and also I give my experience to my other colleagues. You know, if they go something wrong, if there's nothing, they always say, oh, go and ask Mickey. He knows everything.
So I've done a lot of different things, but I still consider myself a railwayman, you know, because of that period at King's Cross. It just also gets into your blood, you know.
Somebody said, what's it like being on the railway, especially being at King's Cross? I said, well, I said, it's best summed up by a Grateful Dead lyric. Sometimes the light comes shining on me, other times I can barely see, but lately it's occurred to me what a long, strange trip it's been.